Right, we're here today at Medlands Fishery, and I'm going to talk to you about one of my favourite types of fishing, which is long pole on the deck for skimmers. But before I go into any detail, one of the most important parts of skimmer fishing is feeding and letting the swim settle. So I'm just going to put four balls in, and then I'll talk to you a little bit more about my rigs, the baits I'm going to be using, and how I'm going to go about things. So let's get these in, and we'll take it from there. Okay, I've put four balls in, just to sort of kickstart the swim, but as I sort of touched upon, I don't want to go straight in over the top of them. I want to give it at least an hour for the swim to settle. So, got the balls in. I've already plumbed the depth, etc. But first of all, I'm just going to talk you through the bait I'm using today. If we start off with ground bait, just mixed a bag of Ringers Natural. Kilo bag, like 800 gram bag to be fair. Mixed it slightly what I'd call over wet. Night before as well, because I want it inert. I'm fishing for skimmers. I want it to stay on the bottom. Don't want to be mixing it on the bank. The other thing with Ringers Natural is it does take a lot of water. So bag of Ringers Natural, and I just over wet it. I had to tweak it this morning, but I want it nice and heavy so it's going to sit on the bottom. Other baits we've got with us, casters. You know, I mean, not a massive fan normally of casters for skimmers, but I have found at Medlands they do like a few casters, so I'm putting a few casters in each ball. Then we've got maggots. Not feeding any maggots, purely for the hook. I'm going to be fishing a single dead, like, single live red maggot on the hook. You might be thinking, why not a dead maggot? And if I was feeder fishing, this might sound strange, I probably would use a dead. But for the pole, I just think a live maggot's better. And also the skimmers hang on to a live maggot that little bit better, so you miss less bites. I've got some fluo pinkies, feeding a few of them. But also it gives me another hook bait, like when it's really cold, water's clear, fishing's hard. Two fluo pinkies, skimmers absolutely love it. Then we've got some worms. Got half a kilo. Wouldn't expect to feed anything like that today, but I do like a bit of worm. The skimmers in here, last time I was here, they did want a bit of worm. So in each ball, I've been putting a pinch of very fine choppy. And when all I've done when it comes to actually putting bait in those balls, I fed four balls. I fed one really soft, so it's going to break down straight away. And then I fed three really hard, so they're going to take a bit longer. The idea being, the soft one will attract the fish straight away, and then the three hard balls take a bit more time and they'll hold the fish. So as I said, I want to leave it an hour. So while I'm waiting for the swim to settle, I'll just run you through my actual rig. Okay, moving on to rigs. Now, for those who don't know Medlands, we're on the Lambsdown. I'm on peg 12, which is one of the deeper areas of the lake. And I've got like a top four and a bit depth wise. So you're looking at sort of 10 foot. So if we move down, first of all, float choice, I've got a 2 gram Carper Gloucester. And I've actually gone for the carbon stem version. The reason being, I'm going to be what I call double bulking, which basically means I'm fishing for lift bites. And I just think carbon's that little bit more buoyant than wire. I normally like wire because it sits better, gives me more stability. But when you're fishing for lifts, I just think carbon accentuates the lift that little bit more. So that's why I've gone from the carbon stem version. The other point with the Gloucester, a nice thick visible bristle. So when you are fishing for lifts, it's just, you can see them that bit easier. You know, I mean, I think there's nothing worse than having a float with too fine a tip, particularly when you're fishing positive and you're struggling to see your bite. So nice thick tip on the Gloucester. I've blacked it out, again, just so I can see it against the sort of white background. Mainline, 015 N-gauge. And if we move down, I've shotted it. I've got a gram and a half Olivet. Then I've got a lot of number nines beneath the Olivet, one number nine above it just to lock it in place. And then above, I've got three little half styles, which are what I call my trimming shot. And I mean, during the course of the session, I might want to just alter the way the float's sitting, maybe a little bit higher, etc. So I've got three little tiny trimming shot. They're dead easy to remove and just allows me to adjust the float really easily and really quickly. So then I've got my Olivet. And then perhaps most importantly with this type of setup, like I'm double bulking, so I've got my Olivet probably, I don't know, 18 inches from the hook. Yeah, 18 inch. And then 6 inches from the hook, just above the hook length, I've got my double bulk, which is my second bottom bulk. That's made up of four number nines. Now the idea with this is, I've plumbed so that I'm like, probably 4 or 5 inches over depth. Moving down, 6 inch hook length, 010 pure fluorocarbon. And then I've got a size 16 F1 pellet hook. You know what I mean, F1, I'm not gonna be fishing pellets on the hook. I just think this is a really nice hook for like maggots and pinkies, as well as the name suggests, pellets. So really simple rig. Lastly, elastic choice. I'll talk to you more about that when we're actually fishing, but I've gone for yellow hydro. There's a chance of hooking a carp here today. I'm not fishing for carp. I could hook one, and yellow hydro will give me a chance of landing it should one come along. But equally, it enables me to hit a skimmer and almost like ship straight back. I don't mean ship straight back at 100 mile an hour. I mean ship straight back nice and smooth, and I'm not going to pull the hook. And I'm not going to get the situation whereby with a barbless hook, there's no elastic out. So the skimmer's going to be basically feeding, it's going to be swirling, knocking its head, get a bit of slack line and the hook falls out. So yellow hydro, nice and soft, perfect for skimmers, but gives me a chance should I hook a carp. So that's the rig. It's about time to do some fishing. So fed the swim roughly 55 minutes ago. We've talked through the rig, the bait, etc. You know, I mean, if this was a match situation now, I'd like to have left it a little bit longer, but as we're filming, I'm a little bit keen to see if there's any skimmers there. In a match, you see, I'd have maybe had a look for a carp if it was in any species match, as in everything counted. And if it was a silvers match, maybe chucked a little cage 30, 35 metres just to try and nick a few fish before going on the pole. So we are going to have a look, and hopefully there'll be a few skimmers there. So single red maggot on the hook. We'll just have a look to see if anything's turned up. When I fed the balls, I've lined them up with a little tuft of grass on the far bank, so I know that I can fish bang on my bait. I mean, it's quite windy today, and ideally, when I'm fishing for skimmers, I always like to fish as long as I can, as in, like, I'd like to have fished 16 metres, but because of this wind, I've come back to 14 and a half. You know, I mean, there's no point. What I didn't want to do is put my bait in at 16 and then not be able to fish over it. So I've come back to 14 and a half. I can fish nice and comfortable. The wind is forecast to get worse later. Oh, a bit of an indication, which is a good sign. So 14 and a half, it's far enough out to catch, but at the same time, if the wind gets up, I still think I should be able to hold it. Just gonna lift it and straighten it again. Just get it over the top of the bait. Pretty sure that first indication was a line bite. There we go, it's sitting just perfect now. The bump bar does make a massive difference in the wind. I mean, it allows you to be more sort of accurate, but equally it allows you to hold the pole a lot easier. Indication then. Like I say, it's a very positive way of fishing, so bites are normally like either nice and slow and just bury, or a lift bite like that one. Just goes to show I was probably 6 inches inside my bait then, just because the wind had pushed it in. As soon as I flicked it out and let it come back across the ground bait, we're into our first, I'm presuming it's a, yeah, small skimmer for Medland standards, but on a cold day, a nice start. And I'm hoping, sort of 12 ounce fish, it'll be the first of many. Here you go. Pretty little fish. Drop him in the net and see if we can repeat the trick. And what I'll be looking to do now is hopefully catch quite a few fish off that initial feed without topping up. Again, I'm just flicking the rig out to make sure it comes round over the bait. That last bite was a nice positive lift. Important to keep your marker as well, so you know exactly where your bait's gone, where your float is in relation to the bait. Sometimes you'll find you can catch just off the bait, but I always like to start fishing bang on it. What I will say as well is, and I didn't do it there, wherever possible, make sure it's on before you strike. It's a very different sort of way of fishing to like F1s, for instance, where I'll be lifting at everything. When I'm skimmer fishing on the long pole, I'm waiting for a positive bite, then it's almost a case of one, two, three, and then hit it, make sure it's on. Particularly in deep water, I don't want to be striking at everything. Right, we're 20 minutes in probably. It's not really going to plan. Plenty of bites. I think I've had like four or five perch, two or three roach, but only two skimmers, which is a bit odd. I'd have expected like maybe 5 or 6 skimmers and not much else. The only thing I'm beginning to wonder is whether the chop worm was a bit of a mistake, but when it comes to topping up, which I won't do yet, I mean, I'm looking at, when the swim dies off, I'll look to top up. When I top up, I might try not putting any choppy in, just to see if that makes the skimmers respond a little bit better. Because I seem to have a lot of little perch in the swim at the minute, which isn't ideal. So I'm thinking next time I come, when it comes to top up, I'll feed a ball, but I'll just put, miss the worm out, maybe fill it full of casters. Don't mind the roach, they're good quality. At the end of the day, I'm here to try and catch skimmers, which I've managed 2, but I'm just surprised by the amount of other fish I've had so far. It's had a bit of a lift then, but it didn't stay lifted. There's definitely plenty of fish in the swim. I'm just not convinced they're all skimmers at the minute. Like I say, the float, I get an odd indication. That's why it's important to wait for a proper bite. But what I'll do is I'll give it another 20 minutes if the bites keep coming. But if I don't get any more skimmers, then I'm going to look to top it up. But let's see how it goes. Right, 45 minutes in now. And it's been good. I've probably had 20 fish. So 20 fish off the initial feed. But I've only had probably 6 skimmers, but only 3 of them have been what I call decent. So I've had perch, roach, probably more roach than everything, which is unusual. So I'm going to top up. Still getting a few bites, and I think there's still fish there, but I want to top up. It is getting slower, so I want to top up before I run out of fish. But unlike the initial balls, I had like pinch of pinky, pinch of caster, and a big pinch of choppy. This time I'm going to put good handful of casters, and a pinch of pinkies and no worms, just to see. It might be that it's just too cold. It's been really cold of late, and it might be that it's just too cold for worms. I mean, skimmers can go off worms, and I'm not really a massive fan of catching those little tiny perch. I don't think they're a great sign either. So this ball is really caster rich. I'm gonna pop that in and just see what sort of difference it makes. Now, it might make no difference at all. It might just be one of those days when the skimmers aren't really having it and it's more roach and more roach and perch, etc. But if we don't try, we won't find out. So let's see what sort of response we get to that. Well, cutting out the worm seems to have been the way to go, because since I put that ball in, I had a little 5-minute quiet spell. Bear in mind there was no worm in that ball at all. And I've had a lovely run now, probably, I don't know, a dozen skimmers between sort of 6 to 12 ounce, well, maybe even a pound. And I've only had 1 perch in that time. And that was a big perch, like a pound fish, so it's worth catching. Interestingly, the roach have vanished as well. So whether it was the fact they were coming to the worm as well, I'm not 100% certain, but there's a lot more fish like that in the swim, which is what I'm after. It just goes to show, I mean, we all think obviously skimmers love worms, and on their day, without doubt, they do. But today, I think the evidence is pretty conclusive that cutting them out has transformed the swim. Gone from like only having 2 skimmers in sort of 45 minutes to virtually every fish is now a skimmer. And it just goes to show how a small change can make a very big difference. Well, it's safe to say that since I cut the worm out, the fishing's just got better and better. I think in 3 hours, I've actually only had to top up 2, which just goes to show the power of the fish meal ground bait as well. I've had a real mixture of size fish, but since I cut the worm out, only that 1 perch and loads of skimmers between sort of, I don't know, 6 ounces like that one, and maybe a pound and a half. So brilliant fishing in the cold weather, but the light's beginning to fade, so you're gonna have to go, but I'm gonna carry on fishing. So I'd just like to say thanks for watching, and I'll see you on the bank sometime.